future, talk radio will actually educate, inspire, and make you think. The future is now. Topics and music that affect your life. From Universal Broadcasting Network. Tune in at ubnradio.com.
And greetings and salutations, everyone. Welcome to Dr. Judy WTF, which of course stands for What the Freud, for those that are new, and thank you very much. I'm your host, Walt Lusk, and in studio as usual is Dr. Judy Rosenberg, a full-time psychologist who has a plethora of patients in more than one office in Beverly Hills and Sherman Oaks. We have a very entertaining show today. Last two shows we did was on how to get over a relationship that you probably should have gotten over a long time ago and how to blow out that torch. And so with Memorial Day coming and summer coming, we thought we'd talk about dating and the men and women that might or might not make you happy, and to find out if that guy or gal that you're dating is or isn't a douchebag. And later on, we're going to shrink a song by a very, very popular song, an artist that I don't think we've shrunk one of their songs
never.
Before.
First
yeah,
time.
So it's about time. Mm-hmm. And thanks for tuning in here at ubnradio.com. You can listen to us on iTunes and pull us on Stitcher and, TuneIn, live and TuneIn, and pull us on iTunes and Stitcher. And, of course, you can write us at info@drjudywpf.com. So, Judy, what's happening?
Oh, a lot of crying women in my practice, which leads us to the topic of how would you call this show, Walt? What did you name it?
Is the guy or gal you're dating, is it a douchebag?
Good. Yeah. Okay, so today I think we're concentrating on douchebag men, yes?
We're going to do both, actually.
I thought maybe this time...
We're going to do a little bit of both.
Okay.
Initially we're going to do mix and match, so we're going to mix and match.
Fine.
And
keep it fair.
We may pick on women since it's a Dr. Judy show. But
thanks.
Don't mention it. You know, it's funny. I've got a little intro here. Dating, it's the nightmare from which you never wake up. Why do we do it? Because it's the best way to find that guy or gal that we want to marry. And why do we want to get married? So we never have to date again.
Although some people don't think that way.
Well, I know they don't. Mm-hmm. But that's really why we're dating. Because, you know what, dating and relationships are great, but, you know, they're never without their unique sets of challenges. Many times the biggest obstacle we face is the type of person we invite in our lives. Mm-hmm. It takes time to get to know the person whom we're dealing with, often to learn that person's identity late in the game. We spend time figuring out what we want, what we don't want, and what we can tolerate and what we can't. We know what's good for us, but sometimes our emotions do lead us astray.
And why do our emotions lead us astray is because it all goes back to what I talk a lot about, the cause.
Cause.
And the reason our picker is broken, as is oftentimes said, is because what we do is we pick familial people to pair up with, and our family of origin is not always the healthiest blueprint. And so when we pick off of the patternings of our family, what oftentimes happens is that we are choosing the perfect wounder in order to heal. And that's why the show is called Dr. Judy WTF with the Freud. And a tribute to Freud came up with the repetition compulsion, which means that we repeat things not because we're stupid. We repeat because we want to heal. So what we're doing, in essence, is we're picking these douchebags into our lives so that we could have a better ending and heal all the wounds that that happened at cause. And so I want to get a little bit into that so that we can lay the foundation for why exactly our picker is broken, or some of our pickers are broken.
And by the way, if you really feel your picker is broken or you have a nightmare story of someone you have dated or are dating, this really is a call-in show, and we really would love for you to get on the couch with Dr. Judy. And the phone number here, if it's live here tonight, is area code 323-843-2826. That's 323-843-2826. So if you feel you want to learn more about your person you're dating and find out if they really are or aren't what you think they are or aren't, feel free to get on the couch. We'd love to hear from you.
So for those of you who've listened to the show before, you might know that I created a mind map for healing human disconnect, and everything that we are in terms of our mental health and unhealth, much of it, I say everything, I mean psychologically everything, and we all know that there are genetic components, but right now we're concentrating on the psychological ones. And the psychological ones have to do with the way that we attach as infants. So what it takes to form a healthy human psyche, according to attachment theory, Dr. John Bowlby from the 30s and 40s did a lot of work with children, babies, and how they attach and how they get injured emotionally. And so the basic foundationals are this. You give birth, breastfeeding, eye contact, consistent care, attunement, meaning that you attune to the needs of your child. You put the child before your own needs. And that
In a perfect world.
In a pretty perfect world, yeah. That's what it takes to form a healthy human psyche, along with a lot of other factors, like it would be nice if mommy and daddy were together and daddy nurtured mom, and it would be excellent if nobody smoked. It would be really great if there was a bunch of financial security. It would be amazing if the parents had ethics and didn't do any form of drugs. So in an ideal world, and a shiny, so to speak, background of emotional nutrients, that's what it would look like. And who gets that? I don't see many people who get that.
Not today, especially not today.
When child care is prevalent. And again, for those of you who have children and your children are in child care, this is not a blame or shame thing. It's just that nature is what it is. And the way that things flow is that children really do need their parents. And so when that bond is broken too soon, or if that bond is inconsistent, then we're going to have big trouble in our lives.
Challenges.
We're going to end up in an office like my office, for example. Today, I had a new person come in, and without revealing too much, obviously, confidentiality, her panel one, meaning her first few years of life, was just absolutely horrific. And I'm going to bring it up as a bit of a case study, because it's not only her, she's representative of many, many people who from the beginning was born to a heroin addict mother. And this heroin addict mother obviously couldn't nurture her, and she ended up in the hands of foster care, and she had multiple foster caregivers in the course of her lifetime, and then finally got adopted out at age 5 with plenty of abuse, physical, sexual, all kinds of abuse in between. And this is not just one example.
No, that story
this
is told over and over and over again.
I can't
again.
Tell you
it's so tragic.
How this is a blueprint
yes.
of many, many cases. Yeah. And so tragically, what happens is that when we are severely damaged at the causal level, meaning the first few years of our life, then we become symptomatic. And some of these symptoms show up in the form of anxiety, panic attack, cutting oneself, alcoholism, major depression, suicidal attempts. I can go on and on. I think you get the drift. I've actually mapped out this process, and if you would be so kind as to put up the mind
And those
map.
Of you listening, you can actually go to drjudywtf.com and see the 9-panel mind map that Dr. Judy developed over a decade ago.
So here's the mind map, and you can access it. And what the mind map represents is 12 years of She's developing a system.
And Dr. Judy really is on the bleeding edge of therapy.
Ouch. Well, bleeding edge meaning that I don't believe that people need to be in years and years of therapy. I mapped out a process that will take people from through to intense sessions with follow-up, of course. I don't expect anybody to pop off the couch without follow-up. But truly intense sessions, people get psychoeducated into the cause of the problem, and we get to actually process the emotions so that they don't have to be stuck with it, and they don't have to do what the Freuds for the rest of their life and relive this horrific nightmare and play it out in bad scenarios and pick douchebags for partners.
See, what Dr. Judy is trying to say is her therapy and approach to all this is a little different than a lot of therapists, not that we're trying to bash anybody, and that is to have you ultimately think like a shrink.
Corny, but true.
No, absolutely true.
Yeah.
And thereby, in a very effective and efficient investment of yourself, you come out thinking like a shrink and can actually be in a situation where it's like, oh my gosh, we talked about this and I remember this, and you actually are able to process it yourself.
And I'm really proud to say that I have an excellent staff of interns and other psychologists, therapists who are trained in the mind map system. So if you can't afford my fees, then please call the Psychological Healing Center, contact us, and we will set you up with a therapist.
It can be done on the phone, it can be done via Skype. So if you can hear this voice, doesn't matter where you are, because this is actually ultimately an international show. We can basically get you therapy.
So the deal is that we're going to work today on looking at how you've encoded what you've encoded and what you need to decode in order to recode the healthy. So we are all encoded with the healthy and unhealthy, the light and the darkness. We have to separate the wheat from the chaff, so to speak, and see what serves us, what doesn't serve us, and then we have to recode what serves us so that we can paradigm shift into health, heal, and balance ourselves, mind, body, and soul. So let's get back to the douchebags. And
again, what Dr. Judy is trying to say is that in order, we love saying on the show, it's a Judaism, if you will, childhood is a hostage situation. And to make yourself not such a hostage of your past, primarily with your childhood and your parents, you need to obviously look in the mirror and get some assistance. And unfortunately, you can't do it by yourself.
Well, we can't do it by ourselves because we have blind spots.
Yes,
and that's
huge.
Why the unconscious is called the unconscious, is because we're not conscious of
Correct.
It. So sometimes it takes an objective observer outside the system to see what's going on. A metaphor that I use a lot in therapy is, imagine if I'm sitting here smiling, right, at everyone, and I've got this big piece of spinach stuck between my teeth, and I don't know, I think I've got this amazing smile, and everybody's going, ugh. Okay, so it would take for Walt to say, hey, Dr. Judy, could you please, do something?
Did you have
about
spinach
that?
For lunch?
Yeah. Okay. So blind spot. I don't know what I don't know. I know what I don't know what I don't know. I know what I don't know. In other words, I know that I don't know how to be a rocket scientist. I know what I know. I know that I know how to be a psychologist, but I don't know what I don't know, and that's our blind spot. And so once we can uncover that piece, and we could then bring the unconscious to the surface and make it conscious so we get power over it.
And that's what we do in the show, as well as with Dr. Judy's practice, is empower folks.
Right. And so that's how we be the cause, not the effect. Yeah. So when we're picking douchebags into our lives, what we're doing is we're being at the effect of our past. We're letting our negative core beliefs run the show. So we hook up with someone that's going to reinforce, I'm not good enough, I'm not beautiful enough, I'm not smart enough, I'm not worthy enough to be loved. And that core belief goes along with the douchebag that then plays out the whole scenario and proves to us that we're really not.
What I thought we'd do is start with six men and six women that in a dating situation probably aren't going to make us happy. So we're trying to be fair and balanced today and see how far we get. And we're probably going to do this next week. So the first one, we're going to men first. A man who hates his job. Okay? And you can chime in. And remember, this is a call-in show, so if you want to say something or something just resonates with you, please pick up the phone and dial. Don't wait. Get on the couch. And the number is area code 323-843-2826. When you spend the majority of your time at work, the destructive mindset, which can poison a relationship if you're dating a guy or a gal that hates their job. I mean, absolutely is miserable in his job and spends a good amount of time, free time, absolutely miserable about it, then obviously that's going to spill over and that's no picnic. So, you know, you don't want to date someone who gets stuck in an unhappy situation and doesn't want to do anything about it because they might not, you know, if they're in a happy relationship, they might not want to do anything about that either.
That's a really great point. And so what happens is when a person is in a job, they need the money, they need the paycheck, they're in a hostage situation
in a sense.
Not
yes,
that they can't leave, but, you know, leaving might mean that they can't pay the rent or feed the kids or, you know, whatever that means to the person. And so what often happens is that they take the anger and the frustration and that energy, and since they can't really bite the hand that feeds them, which is oftentimes their boss, right, they have to put that energy somewhere, and oftentimes this is projected onto the person that they're dating, and that does not make for a happy relationship. It makes for what commonly is known as douchebag behavior. Kicking the dog, right?
Yes, indeed. Uh-huh. Yep. And next is the woman who has no girlfriends. It always amazes me that you ladies are notoriously terrific at getting girlfriends. Doesn't matter where. I mean, you could plop yourself in the middle of a town and, you know, in short order, you've got a lady friend you're hanging out with or going and doing stuff with. So what is it about them that prevents them from being able to relate or befriend another woman? So that's sometimes a telltale sign from us guys is like, you know, you don't have any girlfriends. Not that we want to date them. It's just, hey, you know, usually you guys are really good about having a support group.
Mm-hmm. So I don't know what men assume when they find out that a woman doesn't have girlfriends, but I'm imagining that that woman doesn't know how to take in love, take in nourishment. And so life is hard enough, and we need a support group. We need community around us. I'm learning more and more how important community is.
Yes, indeed.
As I myself try to create more occasions to be with my own family and connect with them, my own friends. It's really, really vital that we have that human connection. This whole system that I created and the show is all about healing human disconnect. So that when we're disconnected from, what we're going to do is we're going to repeat relationships that are disconnecting. So the guy that hates his job is going to come home, and instead of connecting, he's going to be venting. And that's not going to be really nourishing for the relationship. The woman who has no girlfriends isn't full of light in terms of being nurtured.
Or tracked.
Okay, so, yeah.
Or conversely, one of the ones I think I read, maybe we'll get to it, is the guy that, you know, you ladies have all these girlfriends and he's met them 4 or 5 times and he never remembers their names.
Well,
it's
what does
not
that
a good
say
sign.
About the guy?
Well, he might be more into himself.
You think?
Yeah.
Okay, so
yeah.
I've noticed that men who don't remember the name of your family members, that don't remember the important things that you've told them, are just not that invested. They're just not that into you. So they may remember little snippets just to make sure that they can keep you and not threaten the bond enough so that you move on. But they're really, really signaling you that...
Yeah, it's a telltale sign.
That you're just not important enough to be cherished.
And to that end, we're back to the guys. How about the man who is obsessed with his mother?
Oh, we love that one.
Oh, yes.
Okay.
He loves her. Mm-hmm. He defers to her. He consults her about everything.
Uh-huh.
And you are never going to live up to her mom. Or conversely, he hates her, constantly complains about her, and expects you to be the complete opposite of her.
So,
either way, there isn't enough room relationship for you, him, and the great shadow of mom.
Well, I want to elaborate a little bit on that. Marie Bowen, one of my favorite psychiatrists, theoreticians, systems thinkers, talks about separation and individuation, the individuation process, where in healthy development, what we do is we're able to attach to the parent and then gradually separate out, because we have these pillars and nourishers who give us enough emotional supply so that we could venture out in the world. In the case of this particular, right, what's happening is that there's an arrested development and there's no separation and individuation.
Exactly.
And so that person isn't really a grown, mature individual able to be a giver, able to be a nourisher to the person. So it's kind of like you've got this third wheel. The mother might not necessarily be there, you know, in your living room, but
physically,
she's there.
Oh, yeah.
And she needs to be out. And Nick at Night was wonderful last
yes.
time
right.
we
we've
spoke.
Right, we've had a couple.
When he said,
yep.
you know, I made a deal with my wife's family that he was going to, that they were going to help me get mom out of my marriage. And that was healthy. Because now she needs to separate and individuate. And now she can grow.
And it talks about in the Bible, leaving and cleaving. So, you know, it's biblically based. And then we have number 4 of the 12, the woman who thinks life is a romantic comedy. This woman who thinks your relationship isn't working unless you're standing outside her window with a boombox or surprising her with the first edition of her favorite childhood book at regular 3-month intervals. She doesn't understand that life isn't like that in the movies. I believe that was called, the movie was called Say Anything. And she seems incapable of seeing the romance in small moments and quotation gestures as you do your care. So you have to put emotional pressure on the holidays, anniversaries, birthdays, and making any natural romantic inclination seemed forced. And you know what? You need to better find a woman who appreciates the quieter moments in your relationship.
So I think everything's balanced. I do believe that men need to remember birthdays and holidays. You know,
yes.
I'm just a girl,
yes.
okay? And I believe that women do need to feel cherished. So not to take that out of the formula,
absolutely
but
not.
if you see it in extremes, if she needs to be esteemed all the time in this way, then probably what's lying underneath it all is an injury. I call it a narcissistic injury, and that means that she didn't get some of her emotional needs met, and now she's trying to make up the game with the partner that she's with rather than heal the wound that was created at the causal level. So that's what you're seeing, and you'll never be able to do enough because there's that hole in the soul that I talk so much about, that we talk so much
yes,
about,
indeed.
And it's endless, and you can stick all kinds of presents in there and, you know, diamond rings in there, and it's just going to be swallowed up because what's missing here is the foundational, the foundation of self-esteem, the foundation of a sense of self.
And it's interesting. I admit to being single and dating, and I met a lady, and it turned out she wasn't interested in me, and the reason was turned out that on our first date, which was awkward enough as it is, she had this fantasy, I can't even say expectation, that I was going to swoop her up in my arms and give her the biggest kiss in the world, and you know, the clouds were going to open up and the angels were going to sing, and none of that occurred. And so she
didn't
just
occur. I'm so disappointed.
Yeah,
you know, you didn't sweep,
and
that's terrible.
And as a result, she just didn't really think I was the one. It's like going, okay, well, probably not.
You know, it's amazing because people have to earn love. I mean, first you build, this is the way I see it.
No, well, it's foundational.
Like, what is this Insta thing,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
I mean, first you get to know person, you get to know character, it unfolds, you start seeing that there's synergy, there's light between you, and it evolves in layers. And I do believe that when you invest in a relationship and the other person invests in a relationship, you have what I talk about as the one and one is more than two phenomenon, because there's another entity being created here, which is the relationship, which is the we. So there's somebody who didn't want to earn the light. She just wanted it right away.
Yeah, wanted it right away. Or I won't even talk about the lady that on another first date, I went with another lady that we had a great time, and she invited me back to her place. And all she got was a hug goodnight, because, I mean, it's just really all that was really required from me at that point. I wasn't going to dive in any farther. And she thought that was weird. And I'm thinking, okay.
So there's a woman really who doesn't value her boundaries. She was going to give it up so early in the relationship. Mm-hmm. And again, we're not just, I call it, you know, we're not just cans of sardines. Open us up, close us up, discard us when you know, we're done. That's not how, we're mind, body, soul. So anybody that is not a low-hanging fruit, as I've heard it called, is going to have requirements. And so a person who values himself or herself is going to require that a person show them that they're capable of being trusted, will show them that they're capable of honoring their feelings. So it's not just an Insta, here I am, well, sweep me off my feet.
Right.
I mean, how old are you internally? If externally you're 30, 40, 50, 60, internally, that doesn't show great signs of emotional development.
And what I say is we sometimes are living in, or think we're living in, a microwave society,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yeah.
We want it all, and we want it all right now.
Right.
And sometimes we get it all right now, but then, of course, if it's easy come, it's easy go. And if you're just tuning in, thanks for tuning in. You're listening to Dr. Judy, WTF, which is What the Freud, here on UBN Radio Network. You can pull us on Stitcher and iTunes. And while you're doing that, why don't you waltz over to Facebook and like us. We're Dr. Judy WTF on Facebook, or you can send us a Twitter as well. And we're going through dating since we're approaching summer, and figuring out if our girlfriend or guy friend just might be a douchebag.
And for those of you who don't feel that you are dating ready for whatever reason, maybe you feel that you need a makeover on the inside out. And I mean from the inside out, because beauty is within, and we can't help but like more, have a greater affinity for people who keep themselves in healthy condition and care about their appearance. Go to the website at
getting dating ready.
Yeah, get dating ready, but it's on my website.
What is it?
Can,
oh,
yeah.
Okay. Well, it's linked to drjudywtf.
Right, and I have a sub website on there called Get Dating Ready.
Right.
And for those of you who need a little extra help in there, and you're not understanding why people are not choosing you, and they keep getting this "what the Freud" quality to your dating life, then "what the Freud," check it out.
Maybe next week we'll get to an article about six types of guys. We're going to pick on guys. You shouldn't probably date if you meet them online, these type of guys.
Mm, okay.
So next we've got the man who needs to be admired. You're going to like this one. It's not enough to tell him that he's smart and funny and attractive. He needs to feel it and hear it from other people. And he's willing to work for it by consistently flirting with other people as well.
Yuck.
Via email, parties, line at the grocery store, wherever. Mm-hmm. Even though he won't straight out cheat, he'll never feel enough for this man because, well, you aren't.
And no one ever will be.
No.
So don't take this personally. Mm-mm. And I just had a case that really epitomized this. And again, with respect to confidentiality, it was a case of a woman whose husband needed a lot of likes on Facebook, particularly by beautiful women.
Uh-huh.
And he had a problem that she had a problem with that.
Uh-huh.
Okay. So my point is this, is that if you encounter this type of character, you could probably bet on the idea that this person was injured emotionally on the level of either being too spoiled and then he had to fall off the pedestal and it didn't feel so good, so he now has to climb back up, but he has to climb back up every minute with lots of likes and lots of esteemers.
We did a show on this a few weeks ago on social media, and for those type of individuals, they're better off on Instagram.
Oh, Instagram. Okay.
Ah, yes, indeed. Okay. There's only 90 million selfies alone on Instagram.
You know, we are our own biochemistry. We're our own psychopharmacology.
Yeah.
So when we get those little likes, it's almost like these little flashes go off in the brain, little dopamine spurts in there.
Yeah.
And we're loved. But this kind of a guy, again, black hole in the soul. So it'll never be enough. And what's sad about this particular person is that they lack the empathy to understand their impact on that other human being that lives with them while they're off having these emotionally interesting affairs on whatever level.
And we've talked about those kind of individuals. It's like trying to pour everything you can into a glass that's got a big crack in it.
Yes.
As much as you pour into that glass, that never, ever, ever will be full.
And then at the end of that journey, you will feel vampired.
Vampired, absolutely.
You'll wonder why you're drained of energy even being around them.
This one might be a little controversial, but I tend to agree with it. But it's, number six is the woman who expects you to pay for everything always. Maybe it's, you pay for the first date or two or three, or maybe the first four dates. But you know what? You're a generous and chivalrous gentleman. But at some point in the line, the woman has to offer to pay for something. There are more women who are working than men, and now she's definitely making her own money. And the relationship is about equality. Partnership, not meal tickets. So having one partner should not really shovel the burden of all the entertainment in the relationship.
Yeah, and I think that when women become takers, it imbalances the relationship. And the giving and the taking doesn't have to be dollar for dollar.
No,
so in other words,
if a man
is paying for the meals and the woman doesn't want to pay for the meals, what she can do is cook an amazing dinner for the guy. Or she can buy theater tickets and surprise him. Or she can buy an amazing shirt that he's had his eye on. It doesn't have to be tit for tat, in other words. And I do understand that women feel cherished when the guy takes her out on a date. But come on, ladies, kick it in also.
And we have the man who has friends that you've never met. So we've got the woman who doesn't have any friends and the guy who has friends, but you know what? You've never met him. So he's always emailing, texting, or running off to see his friends. Mm-hmm. But you never get invited to come along. And it's not that you suspect he's cheating. It's just the guy who compartmentalizes. We're real good with that. Mm-hmm. His life. And he's clearly not ready to share it with everyone else. Either he's ashamed of you or he's ashamed of them. Either way, it's a red flag.
It sure is. Or he doesn't want to show you signs. He's showing you signs that he's not that committed to you because he's not including you into his circles. Right. So he's still thinking about whether he wants to have you as a permanent fixture. So he'll just keep church and state separated.
Yes, he doesn't want to have that religious of a time.
No.
This one's good. The woman who always has a boyfriend. Looking through her Facebook pictures, you know she's changed her partners more than she's changed her hairstyle. We're not talking about a woman who hooks up with a lot of guys. We're talking about a woman who embarks on a full-on relationship with one guy after another. Cutesy couple of pictures on Facebook and all. The girl hasn't been single since she was 15 years old. And she's got all these ex-boyfriends in there.
Wow.
Let's talk about a hole in the soul.
Right?
Yeah.
Right. So what does that say about her? She's willing to be monogamous. Let's say.
Las Vegas wedding and a Mexican divorce.
But she does. You're right. Las Vegas. Right. But she doesn't have what I call relationship grip. So she probably doesn't have the tools to communicate and conflict resolution. I find this to be very true of couples. They come in, and because they've never really seen their own parents argue and resolve, they don't know how to argue and resolve. They don't understand how it's done because it's never been role modeled them.
So model imagine.
Right. So whenever something goes wrong, they think that the relationship needs to go, and they don't understand that what needs to go are their poor communication skills. And so, just as a by the way, go to the website. You can grab the Peaceful Healing Dialogue
at drjutywtf.com.
Right. And so you can learn how to have relationship grip and learn the tools to connect and not disconnect from the person that you love and continue the connection.
Then we have the man who wants to rescue you. for some reason, he always seems to date people that are complete basket cases because he likes to play the hero. He's the knight in shining armor. He loves to act as a stabilizing force, rescuing women from their situations or themselves, and advising, helping, tranquilizing. But the more troubled the woman is, the more attached he feels he needs to feel needed. The only challenge is the second her life starts to get in order, he loses interest because without her, issues, his focus is taken away and he's left in his own problems and insecurities.
So maybe he should visit Codependence Anonymous.
So CODA, and, we had a show on codependency
right,
a little while ago. Check it out.
So here's the dynamics of a guy who probably played rescuer in the family, and when she started to get better, he didn't know his role any mm-hmm. longer, so he couldn't grow with the new system, the healthier system.
So he's out repeating himself.
Right, so he tries to keep interrupting the growth of the partner so that the system can stay familiar and familial.
Then, of course, the other end of that spectrum is the woman who is a total basket case. She's going through
A hot mess.
A hot mess, absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, there's more than one kind, but she's really having a hard time right now, except that time is always. Mm-hmm. To be clear, we're not talking about a normal woman who's going through a rough period. We're talking about a woman whose very identity is tied up in the fact that she's a hot mess. She's got a temper, she's unpredictable, she's moody, sudden fits of crying, alluding to every, at first even sexy, passion in her life. You can't fix her, but she can't fix things either. And so only a therapist with a hearty prescription can fix it. After her 100th meltdown and the 100th refusal to seek actual help, you might want to run.
Right, and we've talked about borderline personality disorder. Yeah. That would fall under that category, or the histrionic, the person who uses her sexuality to get places in the world. And what's going on there is their inability to soothe themselves. Why? Because the injury is that they were not soothed by their caretaker, usually mother. And so they don't have this built-in emotional thermostat. And so you will be the emotional
thermostat.
You'll be
the thermostat. Hot and cold, hot and cold, hot
right.
and cold until
and
you're,
really
you're fried
tiring.
And
fried.
Burnt out.
Thank you.
Yeah,
good
fried.
Way to put it.
Yep. Then we have a couple more. The man who puts work first. Okay, this could be the woman as well. He's late for dates because he got caught up at work, or he's too exhausted to go out. Mm-hmm. Right? He calls you, an hour before or half an hour before. You're getting all dolled up, and tonight's not the night. When he's with you, he's preoccupied, always trying to solve some problems in his head or itching to get back to the computer at work. He hasn't taken a vacation in years. He promises that things will change, quote, once things calm down a bit.
Which never happens.
The only challenge is never happens.
Did I take the words out of?
Yes,
no.
Indeed.
Mm-hmm.
Never happens.
Right, so here's a person who's a kind of an addict to
yeah.
their computer or to their work, and it's a defense mechanism
yes.
against intimacy.
Yes, it is.
Because they're feeling safe in that world, but what they're not feeling safe with is to open up other chambers of their heart, so to speak, and so they have their heart guard on, and the work is their way of pushing,
making him feel important, justifying their existence.
Sure.
Their other mistress.
Right.
And lastly, we have the woman who hates that you interact with other women. This woman makes you feel guilty for walking down the same street as another woman. I had that one time. I was looking at something, a building or something. I was walking down the street with a date, and mm-hmm. she says, "Well, she's really pretty," and I had no idea what she's talking about. Mm-hmm. I went, "Woo." Mm-hmm. And I didn't even notice. I really didn't. And no amount of compliments, affection, or loyalty could convince her that you aren't interested in anybody else. She's constantly shyly trying to get you to voice your opinion about other women by saying, "Carla's pretty, don't you think?" And then acting as if hurt if you don't dare concede that a yes. This is endless, and it's a very exhausting cycle.
Well, there's a solution. I think that if she could just poke your eyes out... all would be solved.
Oh my goodness, yes, of course.
Of course. Why didn't you think of that? So there's a woman again who is highly insecure. Why? Because she probably didn't have those pillars in her life, the secure attachment.
Right.
And so that anything that you do is going to threaten the bond. And so what she's really doing is she's becoming paranoid and very, very guarding of any cues that signal her that the bond is being threatened. It's possible that her father was a cheater. So what she might
right.
be doing is projecting on you that you might cheat. So any little signal, it's kind of like PTSD. Oh, my God, he
post-traumatic
did this.
Stress disorder.
Thank you. So it's almost like that post-traumatic stress disorder where if something really horrendous happened to you, then you're going to be walking around thinking, I better be on my guard. I better look out for signs that I'm in danger. And this is exactly what's going on, is there's a hyperactive alarm system going on, and it's really tiring. I could remember being out with somebody, and I remember looking at somebody because he was super tall. He must have been about seven feet tall.
Seven feet, huh?
Yeah.
Okay.
And so I looked at this person, and my date at the time said, baby, why are you looking at him like that? Baby, why are you staring at him like that? And just like you, I didn't really understand. It didn't compute in
right,
my
didn't
mind.
Register.
What is he talking about? The guy is a phenomenon. He looks like this, you know, this tall, very interesting.
Tall drink of water.
Tall drink of water.
Yeah.
And I was looking at him because it was an interesting visual for me. No more than that. But because he had a hyperactive alarm system, he was now projecting on me that I was threatening the bond. And, it, you know, one thing that really, really feels horrible is when you're projected upon because you've done nothing wrong, correct? And now all of a sudden you're guilty of something, you don't know what it is, and now you're walking on eggshells because you don't want to hurt the person's feelings, but on the other hand, you don't want to be in that position either. So.
No, and I've been in relationships where we see somebody that's pretty or handsome. I'll go, hey, mm-hmm. you know, he's pretty handsome.
Mm-hmm.
And she'll go, she's kind of cute, right? And that, you know, we've got security in ourselves that we're
right.
just pointing out, you know, I mean, because come on, it's like looking at the scenery and watching people, and you're going to find pretty people and handsome guys.
And it's by agreement.
Yes,
you know,
it is.
Like the couple bubble that guards each other's Achilles heel. So if there's a little bit of jealousy mm-hmm. there, they could have that peaceful healing dialogue and say, look, is it okay if I tell you that I find that lady interesting looking, or I find that guy very handsome? Well, it's really hard on my system. Okay, so, you know, you guard the person, but when it becomes overdone, and again, back to the walking on eggshells, it makes for a very, very narrow, restrictive life.
It's
restrictive.
Well, we're going to have to get to our song here, but you know what? As you can imagine, this has been a fast time here. We've got 13. You're going to have to stay tuned next week, folks. We've got 13 signs if you're dating a douche. Just 13. And then we got five types of for men and women, types of toxic types of men and women you shouldn't date. A little bit of a repeat, I'm sure, but we're going to have some fun with this. So, and if you have some other ideas or suggestions, you can write us at info@drjudywtf or a song you want us to shrink. We always are looking for a great song, and we do take requests and read every email that comes in. And again, if you're realizing you're just repeating yourself over and over and over again, the same kind of person, why do I pick these people? You know what? Get on the phone, call or email Dr. Judy and see about learning more about yourself. As a friend of mine used to say, it's the best investment you can make in yourself. And the song we're going to shrink is actually one by one of the grand dames of all to these days, Taylor Swift. And it's entitled, I Knew You Were in Trouble.
Love the title.
Yeah, so I'm going to read the lyrics, and then this has got some serious lyrics here, and we're going to shrink it. I think when it's all over, it just comes back in flashes, you know? It's like a kaleidoscope of memories. It just comes back, but he never does. I think part of me knew the second I saw him that this would happen.
So there's the memory, the painful memory, and all she's left with, obviously, are just the memories, and there's no return here. So I don't know yet why he's a douchebag, but let's find out.
So shame on, it's not really anything he said or anything he did. It was just a feeling that came along with it. And the crazy thing is, I don't know if I'm going to feel that way again. But I do. But I don't know if I should. I knew his world moved too fast and burned too bright. But I just thought, how can the devil be pulling me towards someone who looks so much like an angel when he smiles at you?
Well, what's really interesting about this paragraph is that it seems like she doesn't think that she deserves him. So mm-hmm. somewhere in there is her own negative core belief, and he's too good for her. But on the other hand, this amazing angel, even a smile from the angel, esteems her so much in the moment that she's just devastated at the loss of having this spectacular person love her. So don't forget, with every douchebag, there is a person that's injured that has a negative core belief that the douchebag is attracting the douchebag.
Maybe he knew that when he saw me, I guess I just lost my balance. I think that's the worst part of all, wasn't losing him, it was losing me.
Wow. Okay, so at least she's a little bit aware yeah. that she's got a bit of a hole in the soul, right? And she's losing herself. And possibly this person picked up on her injuries and went right, zinged right in there. Mm-hmm.
Once upon a time, a few mistakes ago, I was in your sights, you got me alone. You found me. I guess you didn't care. I guess I like that. And when I fell hard, you took a step back without me. And he's long gone when he's next to me, and I realize the blame is on me.
So again, I'm not able to attach. You found me, but you didn't really care. So this person was not really able to make that attachment to the relationship. And as soon as he took a step back,
shame on me.
Yeah, right.
'Cause I knew you were trouble when you walked in. So shame on me now. Flew me to places I'd never been. Till you put me down. Oh, I knew you were trouble when you walked in.
So she knew because her what the Freud part knew, okay, her unconscious somehow detected that he was going to be the wounder and the reopener of all the injuries. So she knew there was trouble, like, uh-oh, I'm falling in love. But what that falling in love feeling often is kind of like a warning sign that you're inviting vulnerability in, and it's very, very risky, and she knew it from the get-go.
So shame on me now. Flew me to places I'd never been. Now I'm lying on the cold, hard ground. Oh, trouble, trouble, trouble. No apologies. He'll never see you cry. Pretends he doesn't know that he's the reason why. You're drowning. Now I heard you moved on from whispers on the street. A new notch in your belt as all I'll ever be. And now I see.
So here she played into somebody that wasn't really that invested in her. And so her wound attracted this douchebag, and although she really didn't know, it still hurts, and she's acting a little bit surprised, but I think deep down inside she knew that she's going to end up on yeah. the cold hard ground. Right.
He was long gone when he met me. Whoa, what a line. And I realized the joke is on me. Yeah, I knew you were trouble when you walked in, so shame on me now. Flew me to places I'd never been till you put me down. Oh, I knew you were trouble when you walked in.
So there it is again. She knew. Flew me to places I'd never been. In other words, he was a great high for her, which was the drug where she needed to be taken to esteem herself. But at the end of the day, he was long gone when he met me, meaning he wasn't even emotionally available.
No, he wasn't.
And
not even
probably,
from the get-go.
Right. She was probably an object and another mm-hmm. notch. And mm-hmm. so she had just been objectified, which is probably her blueprint from the causal level.
And the saddest fear comes creeping in that you never loved me or her or anyone or anything. Yeah. I knew you were trouble when you walked in, so shame on me now. Flew me places I'd never been till you put me down. Oh, I knew you were trouble when you walked in.
Right. So she keeps knowing it, but she keeps repeating it, which is why she needs therapy. And so until she gets this pattern broken, she's going to keep inviting these douchebags into her life who have no empathy, no ability to really attach, use women as objects. And then when she's thrown away, she can feel that horrible feeling that is being most probably recapitulated, repeated from her past. And so now she's got another proof that she's not worthy to be loved, which is her negative core belief.
And I love the last line of the song. I don't know if you know who you are until you lose who you are.
Powerful.
That's very powerful.
Taylor Swift.
Taylor Swift. I knew you were trouble. Mm-hmm. Yes, indeed. So that's our first installment of our show. Whether or not you're dating a douchebag, so you'll have to stay tuned next week to learn more. And you can find us on info@DrJudyWTF, or you can write us on Facebook at DrJudyWTF. I'm your host, Walt Lusk, and Dr. Judy Rosenberg's here. And so stay tuned till next week, and thanks for listening. And here's our song. God bless everyone.